time. I heard a very wise discussion of displacement this morning that my foundation is working on, and this was priceless to us to have the direct voices on the ground. And it's been a great conversation on how we implement the Paris Agreement and on how we make sure that this great global commitment translates into meaningful and positive change at the local level, and how local communities can inform that this change, which is vital so that we can ensure that we do stay at 1.5 degrees Celsius, the goal, and all the time ensuring that people are at the center of the discussion so that we achieve climate justice. Is that better?
Yeah.
That better?
Yeah.
Am I echoing quite so much?
Yeah.
Thankfully. So in a way, you're all part of this discussion, and we're going to make this session as interactive as we can, and use the messages that you have contributed to inform the discussion. I've already introduced the Minister of Haiti, so let me now introduce the other panellists. Kathy, General Kitchener, climate action activist and poet from the Republic of the Marshall Islands, who made such a fantastic impact at the summit last in 2014 in New York. Yuba Sukona, head of the Interim Independent Delivery Unit of the Africa Renewable Energy Initiative and vice chair of the IPCC. Great to have you here, Yuba. Hindu Oumarou Ibrahim, coordinator of the Association of Indigenous Women and Peoples of Tchad. Wonderful to have you. I see you on every panel nowadays. I mean, you know, the single transferable panelist is about, but it's great to have you. It's great to have you here. And on my on this side, James Close, director of the Climate Change Group of the World Bank, and Patrick Fury, community resilience manager from the Red Cross in Malawi. You recall that we've been speaking in three tracks, and we've been speaking in three different tracks. The first one is action towards climate ambition, in the Paris ambition, and Yuba and Kathy will speak to that. But because we have a limited time of the minister, we want to make sure we maximise that limited time. So we're going to actually start with track two, and track two is on just and equitable decision making, and it's important that we have an opportunity to hear the way in which, Minister, you as a champion of climate justice and of women's leadership, how can we bring the voices of women and vulnerable communities into the negotiations? And I know that you would prefer to speak in French, but you're going to speak in English because more people understand English.
Very approximate in English. Thank you, Mary. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share together with you what I think. Before being champion, first a mother of three daughters and grandma for one young kid. And I was fighting during all my life for two issues. First one is sustainable development, environment. This is my field. And second one was women. But I was not fighting for women as a woman. I was fighting for the issue of women, because this is not a women issue. I'm so delighted to see men here in this session and women, because this is a society issue. We can't build this new world we are dreaming of from Paris without women. Women are in the heart of the global transformation. Paris was an amazing and historical agreement, and Paris was just a fair agreement. But today, today, we are here in COP22 to implement the Paris Agreement. to implement the Paris Agreement means that we need to change all our habit. We need to change the way we produce. We need to change the way we are consuming. We need to change the way we are building, transporting, etc., etc. We need to change our culture, and we need to change the way we are dealing with the development. Until now, we have dealt with the development without women, and we can't do anymore because women, with the issue of climate change, are in the heart of the issue. Women are the one who are the most vulnerable to climate change. Women are the one who are working on the landfills, on the lands and agriculture. They are representing 40% of the tax force in Africa, if we speak only about Africa. So women are the one who are most threatened by climate change. But women are the part of the solution too. So we can deal this global transformation without women. And thanks to the leadership of this woman, Mary Robinson, I don't have the answer for your question. You have, because together with you, we have lobbied in Paris to introduce gender in all the agreements. We have lobbied here to have the first decision on the women, on the gender issue, on the decision of COP22, and I would like to congratulate you for that. The issue is now how to make the gender issue a cross-cutting issue in all the articles of the Paris Agreement, because we are both involved in mitigation and in adaptation. And you can, all of us know that we don't have only CEO men, we have CEOs women. We don't only have mayors men, we have also mayors women. So I think that this is now the time to be able to work together, hand in hand, we say it in English, to build this global transformation. Paris Agreement is waiting. This is a process, and a long-term process. We will not change and climate change in 2 days or in 12 days during COP22. We have to build the process, and we can't build the right process without 50% of the world, which are women. So women are there, and I would like by the same occasion to invite all of you to the Summit of Women Leaders and Global Transformation, which will be held on the 16th of the, in the PGP Palace, is the Palmeret Palace Hotel. We will bring first ladies, they were not involved in the discussion. We will bring CEOs, women CEOs, they were not involved in the discussion. We will bring all the leaders, women leaders, to discuss this issue and to be part of the global transformation.
Well, thank you very much for that open invitation, which I hope people will take seriously on the 16th to your wonderful summit of women leaders. Now, Minister, I'd like to invite Hindu to give you a sense, not just as you have so eloquently framed it, about women's participation, but also the other issues that are related to the session that we had on just and equitable decision making for climate resilience. Hindu, and then Minister, if you could respond to Hindu, that would be wonderful.
Thank you very much, Mary, for this invitation, and it's my pleasure really to resume the track number two of the two-day working outcome in this how to give place to all the stakeholders at the decision making. Yes, I hear from Minister Al Haiti about women participation and how it's going. I'm going to be beyond this one. We get the decision during the Paris, and we saw the leadership of participation at the decision making would take us to the Paris Agreement entering to the force. But we said we want to have action, and we want to implement the Paris Agreement. So from the two-day discussions, we saw that to implement this one, the decisions have to cope at a different level. At the international level, yes, into the negotiation, but at the national and local level. So at the international level, how this one can go beyond the barriers who are already there? There is always the same issue, same people sitting to the table and discuss. So on this one, as indigenous peoples, and we do have the decision 135 on the knowledge platform, we say traditional knowledge, indigenous people's knowledge are very important, but we cannot do that without taking the same place into the decisions. We propose the knowledge platform, how we can have the full and effective participation of indigenous peoples in this one. And when we participate, we don't want to just listen from you. How the peoples can listen from us? Because the solution are coming from us, the knowledge are coming from us. If we don't have space, and we cannot say whatever that we want this platform work, it's cannot going to happen concretely and achieve the goal that we have. And secondly, how we can do that at the local and national level, these decisions. And what's come up from the discussions also, there is a language barriers. We saw that here. Like into the negotiation is only English is working, but we do have six language into the UN. So when you go back at the national and local level, how these decisions can be transferred to the local language, to the national language, then communities, peoples can understand and they can be taken into the consideration. That's really a big challenge, but we need that for the actions. So another one, how we can include the social aspect. We cannot go to the solution without respecting the human rights, indigenous people rights. And when we say that, we do have many solutions. Now we are talking a lot about renewable energy, and we talk a lot about the solars and the things. But if there is a big dam for the clean energy, or a big land grabbing to make just a solar power or wind, it's not anymore a clean energy because it's violating the rights of the people, displacing peoples, or destroying biodiversity by the big dam. So those are not the sustainable solution. How we can get this one really clear and involve peoples and give them the right solution on it. So those come from the two-day discussion and how you can ensure us it can really work here in the decision you are taking.
Thank you, Hindu. And you know, I did a meeting together with you, and we proposed to the UNFCCC already that the indigenous people practices or best practices should be registered in the NASCA platform. This is the first thing. But we think that we need to have dialogue together with the different group of negotiation and with the bodies of the UNFCCC to find the right place when you can deliver your message and when you can participate as a representative of the indigenous people. You make terrible for me this exercise. Okay, so this is the first point. So I think that we can organize this together with you and with the UNFCCC and under the leadership of Mary. The second point concerning the local communication and how we can implement it locally, I think that this is a local issue. The country has to develop its own strategy. We are creating the framework here. We are saying, okay, we are going to decarbonize, we are going to switch to low carbon technologies. This is what we are doing, and the indices of the countries should come through or should be the result of the vision of the country, the strategy of the country, and you have the NDC, and then you have to implement your NDC locally. So I think this is more related to capacity building, because nobody will tell you how to choose your project. What you need to present is a bankable project with a low carbon technology which is adapted to your specificity, to your culture, to your practices. And then what we need to work on together with the Green Fund, with the financial institution, with the UNFCCC community, is how to make this link together with you and how to give access to such local projects coming from the indigenous people. I think that the debate we had before, together between the indigenous people and the UNFCCC, was not a debate-oriented action. Now we need to switch to this debate, to be constructive and to say that we need platforms for discussion, we need platforms and tools for finance, we need maybe to discuss with the Green Fund a quota for the indigenous people, I don't know, but we need to discuss such issues with the right organization, with the right bodies of the UNFCCC to be able to find out what are the right solutions for you.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you for responding. In fact, I was also aware that one of the first things you mentioned was the gender decision, and it now includes valuing local and indigenous knowledge, valuing the participation of grassroots women. So we have already made a significant progress in creating a potential platform, which Hindu, you have to make a real platform and make sure.
It was not easy.
It was not easy, I know. But, well, thank you so much. I promised you that we would not keep you longer than the few minutes that you had, and all the best for the rest of this COP, and in particular for the issues that we're discussing here in the Development and Climate Days. And we will all, I hope, come to your wonderful summit of women leaders.
Thank you.
On the CC.
We know that you have the support.